Vowels and vowel-like articulations is an important discussion in phonetics and phonology. We are required to analyze vowels and vowel-like articulations in various languages, right? Because without understanding the nature of vowels of a particular community, we won't be able to analyze the articulatory features of that community, and then cannot be, you know, developing our discussion on the basis of the phonological features of that community, right? So in order to discuss vowels, we have been discussing in very traditional methodology three aspects of vowels, right? Like we talked about the, you know, the height of tongue, right? In traditional methodology, right? That what's the position of the tongue? Is it high or mid-high, right? Or mid-low or low? On the basis of those, you know, cardinal vowel positions, right? So four corners for the frontal part of the tongue. And then we also talked about the back part of the tongue from a height point of view, right? Like the low, the mid-low, the mid-high, and the high, right? So starting from the front, coming down, right? And then from the down, from the bottom, going up, right? So that was the, you know, the shape of the cardinal vowel through which we discussed in traditional manners the description of vowel, right? Then we also talked about the part of the tongue, that from which part of the tongue specific vowels are produced, right? Is it the front part of the tongue or the mid position, the center of the tongue, or the back position of the tongue, the back part of the tongue, basically. So this, you know, height and backness, right? We developed the idea that the acoustic features are quite related to this traditional methodology. And then the third factor for vowels we discussed earlier was the lip rounding, that whether a vowel is unrounded, right, with stretched, you know, lips, like E, E, right? The neutral position of lips is there, or there is something like half rounding, like right? So that half rounding, and then we also used like the term of rounded vowels, right? So lip position was our third category for, you know, describing vowels, right? And we discussed within the acoustic portion of this course that F1 is related to the position of tongue in terms of low and high, right? And we found that there was an inverse relationship between F1 and the height of tongue, right? Because the lower is F1, the higher is the tongue, right? And when the F1 is increasing, the tongue position is going down, right? So increased F1, the lower is the position. So that was our, you know, connection between the acoustic features and then the traditional features of our description of vowels. Then we discussed that the front-back differences of the parts of the tongue, F2 was quite important, right? And we found in the course that there is a very positive relationship between F2 and then the frontness or the backness of, you know, the tongue, right? Because the more is F2, it is increased in value, increased in number, then the more is it's produced from the front part of the tongue. Like the maximum F2 was found through the sample of the American vowels in E, right? And that was, you know, maximum F2 and the maximum at the frontal part of the tongue that was produced, right? Now, talking about the lip rounding, that lip rounding acoustically is connected with the lowering of F2 and F3, right? Like in our discussion on the bilabial consonants, we talked about the, you know, the lowering of the second and third formant, right? So there is a connection that the degree of lip rounding is also realized in the acoustic analysis of vowels, right? So the relative distances between vowels are also important, and those are determined through the traditional articulatory and auditory features right? Because the traditional description of vowels is based on the auditory abilities of the listeners, okay? Like when we talk about the high-low position of the tongue or the big front position of the tongue, part of the tongue, and then also about the auditory, then those are the features which are related to the auditory abilities, like the auditory features of the sounds, right? But on the other hand, the acoustic features are based on the, you know, the articulatory manners, right? Like the articulatory features of the sound. And we discussed that there is, interestingly, quite a great, you know, connection found in the traditional methodology and then the acoustic experimental methodology. Now, talking about the location precisely through which the sounds are produced, that's an important discussion, and we would continue this in our next session.